So you have a high-level idea of what it is that you want to do, whether it is to automate a system or just to visualize a system so that you can look for efficiencies later on. But how do you go about figuring out the detail of the system? If you're exceptionally lucky, there will be a guide in place which users of the system will follow every time they use the system. In my experience, however, more often than not, this won't be the case. Either the guide will be out of date, or the system's users won't follow the series of steps very rigidly, or there won't be a guide in place at all, either because it's a completely new system that you're looking at, or because no one has actually taken the time to create one. Whenever you're in a position where users of the system don't follow a guide rigidly, you should always make an effort to talk to the users and ask them for their input. If there's a guide in place and the users don't follow it, you will need to know why not. Is it out of date or has the user memorized it? If there's no list of steps to follow for the system, but there are steps for other systems, is that because the system is too complex and no one wanted to spend time documenting the complex system? Or is the system used so rarely that it's not worth documenting the steps? By answering these questions and other questions like them, you'll be able to figure out a lot about the owner of the system. If you answer these questions and you get the impression that the owner doesn't actually care about the system very much, that usually means that you're going to need to do more work than if the owner of the system does really care about the system. If the owner doesn't care for the system, it will most likely fall to you to figure out the entire system, not just visualize what is currently in place. If you're left figuring out the entire system, the best way is to talk to as many users of the system as possible. If you're doing this for a company, they may want to give you access to one person who they expect will give you all the information that you need. But in reality, if you're working on a system whose steps are not documented, you will be able to do a much better job by asking the input from multiple users. If different people are taking different steps, you need to be able to establish the best practice, and sometimes the efficiencies that the company is seeking can be found just by having a common set of instructions that all people follow. It will certainly improve consistency. If you sit down with different users, you should take whatever they say away with you and create a list of steps that they've listed. When you have this list, go back to them and ask them to confirm that you have included every step. The reality is that people can and will make mistakes, and it's unlikely that you will learn an entire process from just a single run-through of the process, so be prepared to make more changes. This is where the agile methodology comes into its own. Take multiple attempts at documenting the process, and ask for validation from the users frequently. Also remember that there are different types of users, and they will contribute in different ways. If you have a frontline worker running you through a system, they will likely be able to answer most questions about the low-level process, but their knowledge of higher-level things may be lacking. Similarly, if you ask a mid-level manager about the low-level workings of the system, their knowledge likely won't rival any frontline workers. And the same goes for executives, who may know lots about the high-level things and why things operate in a certain way at their level. But ask them to explain the low-level detail, and they will likely look at you with a confused look of bemusement. If you combine the knowledge you are able to gather from talking to different people at different levels, you will have a much, much greater understanding of the workings of the current system, which in turn will hopefully make any solutions or enhancements you recommend more fit for purpose. After talking to various people about the system and what it's used for, certain functionality that the system must be able to do will begin to emerge, which becomes the requirements for a new system or enhancements that you suggest in the future. An executive of a company might tell you that the company needs the system to be secure so that any customer data which is put into the system can only be accessed under the correct circumstances. A mid-manager might tell you that the system must be able to record who is making changes and what changes are being made, and how often changes are being made so that they can monitor how productive their staff are being. A frontline worker might tell you that the system must be easy to use and ultimately make their role easier, which probably means some sort of automation of the process that require a lot of time or don't add any real value to the process. But how do you decide how important each of these requirements are, and which ones the company could do without if they really wanted to? The easiest way to do this is to break each of the requirements you gather down into functional requirements and non-functional requirements. Functional requirements are anything that the system needs to be able to perform in order to be able to operate, and non-functional requirements are those requirements which the system technically doesn't need to be able to do in order to perform its core purpose. If you think of an ATM, for example, its core purpose is to give users the ability to withdraw money from their bank account. If you use this definition, however, typing your PIN is a non-functional requirement, because if ATMs didn't ask you for a PIN, it would still be able to give you access to your money, it just wouldn't be very secure. If you took away the ATM's ability to dispense cash, however, then the ATM would no longer be able to fulfill its purpose, and so the ability to dispense cash is a functional requirement. I wouldn't go as far as to say that non-functional requirements are optional, but they do definitely fall into the like to have side of things, while functional requirements are much more must-haves. Breaking the requirements down into these categories can be quite difficult. If you think of the examples we mentioned earlier, each user was saying that the new system must have each of these features. But if you break the requirements down, you can see that each of these are all non-functional requirements, even the user says that the new system must do these things. So now you have broken down the process into these non-functional and functional requirements, you can start to consider different alternatives to the current system. If you are looking for a new jacket, for example, you would have a list of functional specifications that the jacket must meet for you to consider it. Things like the size of your body, as well as some requirements that you would like the jacket to have, things like being thick if you're going to wear it in the winter maybe, and the colour of the jacket if you wanted it to be a specific colour. If you saw a nice thick jacket in the colour you wanted, which wasn't available in your size, you wouldn't buy it, even if it did fulfil your non-functional requirements of being thick enough for wearing during the winter and being the colour that you liked. When you have found a solution that has all of the functional requirements, then you can start considering the non-functional requirements to narrow down your options to something that the company will actually want to use. Okay, but everyone in the company said they wanted specific things, and none of those were functional requirements. Why not go out and look for the non-functional requirements that the company gave us first? Well, let's imagine what would happen if we were looking for non-functional requirements first. Let's imagine that we were asked by a Dubai sheikh to create a perfect horse to race in the Dubai desert. Well, the desert has a lot of sand and dust, so the prince says he wants the horse to have big eyelashes so that it can keep the dust out of its eyes. There are lots of shrubs and plants in the desert, so having long legs would be good so it can step over things more easily. The desert is also very dry, so the horse should be able to carry enough water so that it doesn't need to drink very often. All of a sudden, what starts as a horse has more or less turned into a camel. Camels aren't as fast as racehorses, so imagine how annoyed the prince will be after spending all this money developing what should be a superior horse, and he gets this camel which can't even compete with the horse it's racing against. The framework we're going to use to accomplish this is called the Structured Systems Analysis and Design Methodology, or SSADM for short. We will also look at UML, or Unified Modeling Language, in the second half of this series too.